So let me write down the sequence of things we have been doing, and then you can see. So so far is that we defined the quantum mechanics through path integral. Which actually meant through transition amplitudes. But we basically checked that this gives correct kernel. For the free particle. Now, from this point on, we introduce this method of external current. Or forcing function. And this is a method, there is no real forcing function. So this is method of forcing function, which will later become external current. This is Schwinger's way of thinking of it. We also made a transition from transition amplitude to vacuum amplitude. Okay. Again, a concept essentially due to Schwinger. Vacuum to vacuum amplitude is apparently a fake thing, because why would you, what would you learn from going from vacuum to vacuum? It's like being back to square one. But the point is that in fact the vacuum to vacuum amplitude is done in the presence of the forcing function. So you get a vacuum to vacuum amplitude in the presence of, as a function of this auxiliary variable, and then by varying this variable you can obtain all the information back. Okay. So but this is as a function of functional of the forcing function. And that is the key thing, that you obtain the vacuum to vacuum amplitude in terms of the forcing function, and then this force W of J becomes the generating function, generating functional of endpoint functions or green functions. So that is what we have done so far. So we can say what happens is that we do omega plus infinity, omega minus infinity to be equal to integral over dqf dqi of omega plus, so omega infinity qf tf times the more physically transparent transition amplitude right, this is obvious getting and in the presence of a current J, this what did we call it, F over there, yeah, F. So vacuum to vacuum amplitude in the presence of F basically takes this form, and then this becomes, we saw in the limit that we take T and this here we take Tf Ti to also infinity, infinity and minus infinity. We basically recover plus I, the basic path integral is with I, integral minus infinity to infinity dt of whatever the action is, we have been writing in terms of qq dot t, but plus I times integral qt j of t, f of t. Now at this point itself, we can observe that if we define correlation functions as not phi, I'm sorry, q t2 q t1 as equal to 1 over I d by d f t2 1 over I d by d f t1 of that transition amplitude. And evaluated at f equal to 0. This is all we did so far effectively, except for the calculation method of doing quadratic integrals to recast the path integral in various ways, and of course we will be using it again and again. We also use the stationary phase method to check that the path integral has to become stationary on the classical path. So but other than that, this is all there is, and if you have n points, then you put n of those and then you can recover the answer. There is an illusion among people that path integral is a good thing to do quantum mechanics. This is completely wrong. The main use of path integral is only after you make transition to quantum field theory, and then to derive relations between Green's functions. So QFT again has been used primarily as an S matrix theory. The only thing we do, so we tell everybody to get them excited that we are calculating n point functions, but what we really have in mind is calculating scattering of n particles. So all we do is there is a very formal procedure which then converts the n point function into the n point S matrix, n particle S matrix. So we calculate those transition amplitudes, the S matrix, and not necessarily energy stationary states. So in fact QFT fails completely, I shouldn't say completely, but QFT has not proved to be very useful to compute any bound states, nor is path integral very useful. I know that there are several textbooks, entire textbooks written on how path integral is very useful in quantum mechanics. Well, you can read them for their own value, whatever they have, but I have never read them, and I can vouch that no chemist will need them to calculate the many electron bound states. Okay. The chemists do use, however, the Green's function ideas, because they want, so Green's function ideas make it a little bit more formal and peg it on a slightly different level, but path integral is not going to be, so the only computation you can really do with path integral is the Gaussian integral. And later we will see that it helps you to derive the so-called diagrams, so-called Wick contraction at two point functions at a time. But there is the kind of power that you have in a partial differential equation, which allows you to solve, I mean, hope for getting exact solutions for many different potentials, that does not exist in quantum field theory. And in quantum field theory, so primary use of this method has been to calculate S matrix elements. If you want to calculate, so I can even write it down here. How should I say? Becomes most useful. Thank you. So this beta Salpeter functional equation has been studied by a lot of people and lot of work exists, but I don't think we were never taught that it calculates baryon, and if it was, then we would be not doing lattice gauge theory. So that is the status. But we can also say the other use of the functional formalism is in fact to implement this theory on the lattice. You can implement quantum theory on the lattice in this functional formalism. So for lattice gauge theory also it's a useful thing, but lattice gauge theory is then just a completely numerical calculation. It's Monte Carlo calculation of that functional integral, because there is no, the only approximation schemes, the only exact calculation schemes available is the Gaussian integral or the so-called steepest descent method in some approximation you can, it's like the stationary phase, we will see it. So there are very few tricks available at the functional level that allow you any kind of quote answer, but this trick does allow you to obtain functional relationships. The trick of partition function, trick of your partition function in statistical mechanics also one uses something similar. So that is really the all there is to it, okay, but it is extremely powerful for the purpose for which we are going to do it. The conversion from Green's function to S matrix is itself quite a formal statement, but once you get over it, you get used to the idea. It's not all that difficult. Hopefully, I will be able to do it if I have the time. There is a 2, I think. So we have to interpret this as product over all E. Where you have to order the E's, the energy spectrum, because path integrals are always ordered. And that was one thing I was going to comment here, I forgot. Where we wrote this Green's function, we actually end up calculating only the time ordered product. So it is automatic in path integral that you will get the functional method, that you will get the time ordered product. So this is the W0, and the W which is not of much interest anymore, and the other part in detail is well, let me see if I can say it without. only thing is the sign in D, and it's not square root because, okay, so T1 minus T2, there is a minus sign, right. The square root is in the Fourier transform definition, but here it is not there. And E squared minus omega squared plus I epsilon, yeah. Right, so everyone knows all this, and you know that this boils down to theta. So, where should we write? Okay. I E will be equal to omega, so I omega t and plus theta of t2 minus t1 times e raised to plus I omega t. Think there is a 1 over 2 I omega from the poles, right? So, yeah. Because it is square, you will be taking e plus omega, e minus omega, and each one is a pole. So from each of the poles, you get each of the poles relevant depending on whether this is greater or that is greater than 0, and the value of the pole is that. The 2 pi goes in the integration, okay, in the contour integral. Thinking, and it was a great discovery when Feynman used this propagator that positive frequency particles go forward in time. So omega is a positive number, it is positive square root of the omega squared. So it gets a minus sign, which is the correct time evolution according to Schrodinger convention of setting energy operator to be equal to plus I d by dt. So with the minus I, it gives correct omega. So this is going forward in time, but this would give negative energy or would go backward in time, and that is the interpretation. If this has not been told you before, I might as well spend a little time here telling you about is going forward and backward, because this is at the heart of causality in quantum field theory. So is the or it should be there in, so this is a very general argument, and the way Weinberg puts it particularly is that, so look at the uncertainty principles. Uncertainty principle, there would be four statements, but look at say dE by dE dt uncertainty principle. If you try to, but in relativity it is not delta t and delta x that really matter, because one person's t is another person's mixture of t and x. And actually Weinberg writes a so-called uncertainty principle, which is written like this. So it basically says that the space-time interval between two observations has to remain greater than the Compton wavelength. Okay. So you can think of this, you can put the m on this side and treat it as if it is, well, not really, but this is the form in which it is written in his book, and you can see what this is saying is that you can have single particle interpretation only provided you don't probe the object in space-time intervals that are smaller than the Compton wavelength. Okay, so delta E delta P. No, so we, I meant to say delta T square minus delta X square, yeah. But now in quantum mechanics, you could always probe the system more closely, and then you will lose the single particle interpretation, as you have been taught probably in most relativistic quantum mechanics courses emphasize that you will create particles. If you probe at this length scales shorter than this, then the value of delta E and delta E will have to be larger than the mass scale of the particle, and you will end up creating more particles and the single particle interpretation will be lost. But we also have a more specific statement. Suppose that I have creation of a particle. So now we draw this space-time diagram and the light cone. Normally, if you create a particle here, it will be later found here, right? So this is T1 and T2. So it will propagate from this to this. But quantum mechanics only tells you some inequalities. It does not say delta X cannot be less than something or delta T. All that you have to do is maintain this. But if this happens, you could also have a situation where T1 is here and T2 is here. Okay, so T1 prime, I don't want, so I will remove the old T1, T2. So suppose it is T1 and T2 like this. This may not be forbidden by this relation, because all I have to do is adjust that the delta T square is bigger than minus delta X square remains bigger than this M square, and well, actually it will be negative in that case. But because I don't have control in quantum mechanics, it may very well happen that I create a particle here but destroy over there. This is the also say Bell inequality thing. You do something here and it gets also, it determines something over there. So the point is that we recover the causality correctly in this case, because it is possible for you to, here the events are space-like separated. So it is always possible to at least reverse the time. Okay, for space-like separated events, it is possible to reorient. This is a little, let us see, how does one recover? I'd have to really tilt it a lot until the projection onto that axis reverses the directions of T1 and T2. Right? If it is a space-like separated interval, then I can, and if I choose my new axis to be like this, then now I have to do a projection parallel to this axis. So this will go, so I have to make the slope of this bigger than this. So sorry. So I do this and this. So this is T1 and this is T2. Right, clear. T1, T2. But now, and this has a slope like this. So I draw a new choice of axis, which is highly relativistic. So it is approaching the light cone, very thin, close to light cone. If I now project these by drawing lines parallel to this, they will go and hit the time axis in the reverse order. Intersected it already, right? So the time, yeah. Correct. And this one from here to draw like this until we hit this axis. Okay. Already there. Yeah. So if you will do this carefully in your notebook, you will see that the projections which are, this is the new x prime axis, the projections, projection lines parallel to x prime axis which go and hit t prime axis, the t1 and t2 are reversed. I mean, the well known result, and you can find the algebraic expression for the Lorentz boost required for this to happen. So now there is a question of causality, that you emit a particle here but absorb it here, which is at a later time in this frame of reference. In the other frame of reference, it will look as if it got emitted first and got absorbed later. This problem is solved by quantum field theory. Because of this, because in the other frame of reference, it will look like an opposite charge particle went backward in time. Okay. That is what the interpretation is. So for a charge system, Q plus Q created at T1 and absorbed at T2 is equivalent to minus Q created at T2 and absorbed at T1. So this amounts to the T1 location reducing its charge in both the things. What is same is, thus both the charge of one is reduced and that of two is increased. In the person who is observing frame of reference, as his clock is ticking, he considers time sequence as going forward in time strictly, and in if the two events due to the this uncertainty in some, this is what I meant to suggest, in some space time region, well actually it will not be a circle but some kind of hyperboloid, when so long as this is of the order of m, anything can happen here. In particular, a particle can get produced and annihilated at space like separated points, and if that happens with a particular time sequence and if it is space like separated in another one, it will look like creation event is happening after the destruction event. Well, that is not true, because it will be in his frame, in the other observer's frame of reference, it will be interpreted as minus Q sequentially got created at T2 prime, which in this frame of reference occurs before T1 prime. We will find that if you compute the for a massive field, if so, for massless fields, we will find that the support is only on the light cone. So if you are sitting at, you start with the origin as the reference, the Green's function, the Feynman propagator will have support only on the light cone, only on these points, outside of that it vanishes. But if you do it for a massive particle, then you find some slightly different function which has of course higher support here, but it also has a little tail outside. It is not strictly on the light cone. It is an exponentially dying tail, just like in a barrier problem. Barrier problem, the wave function penetrates under the barrier. So in quantum field theory, the 2-point Green's function will actually protrude into the classical relativity forbidden zone, but exactly of the order of the Compton wavelength and not more. And if things happen in that region, so if you see creation destruction events in that region, they will be resolved by this explanation.